Hello everyone, I hope you're doing well. First, I would like to thank those who are now properly submitting the homework in the submission field instead of the comments box. Thank you, I appreciate that. Second, we will be exploring chapters 8 and 9 this week. We will skip chapters 10 and 11. If you want to read those chapters, you will be doing so for your own cognitive growth and enjoyment, and I urge you to do so, but I'm letting you know that we will not be tested on chapters 10 and 11. They're not in the syllabus. We're not going to cover them. You're not going to be tested on them. Okay, what we're going to cover this week is chapters 8 and 9. Chapter 8 asks you to take ordinary English sentences and translate them into categorical statements. The four options for categorical statements that we have are as follows. These are your four options. All SRP, no SRP, some SRP, some SRNP. An ordinary English statement has to be in that form in order to be into standard form as a categorical statement. So for example, if you're given cats are animals, that has to become all cats are animals, all SRP. If you're told only students are allowed in this prom, that would become all persons allowed in this prom are students. Okay, I think you get it. You're gonna have to practice. Like any kind of translation, it takes a lot of practice, and soon you'll find yourself really picking it up. The interesting part is once you can put statements into standard form, you can use this incredible tool discovered by Aristotle 2400 years ago to reveal and understand the relationships between these kinds of statements. And the tool I'm referring to is what's called the square of opposition. Now, things get really interesting here, folks, so prepare yourself. We're about to go into the rabbit hole of logic. Here we go. And look at that rabbit. It kind of looks like me, that rabbit. It's a bit frightening, perhaps a Freudian thing. We'll have to explore that later. Okay, the square of opposition. Here's what it looks like. Again, using very sophisticated technology. Note, with the square of opposition, if the A statement is true, the O statement must be false because they are contradictories. If E is false, I is true. If I is true, E is false. Contradictories. The relationship between the subalternates right here, or subalternation statements, you're going to have to explore on your own in the book. And also the relationships between the contraries right here, the A and E statements, and relationships between subcontraries, I and O. I urge you to think about the relationships here and try to figure them out on your own before you read about them in the book. Ask yourself questions such as, can both of these statements be true, or is it the case that if one is true, the other one's false? Can they both be false? Ask that question of the subcontraries as well. Can they both be true? It seems like they could. Could they both be false? Well, it seems like they couldn't. Try to figure out why. Consider this relationship. If A is true, does I have to be true? Think about that. If I is true, does A have to be true? Explore this incredible tool revealed, discovered, however you see it, by the incredible genius Aristotle 2400 years ago, and I hope you carry it with you throughout your life. It's fascinating to think about, especially when people in life throw out generalizations about other people. You know, somebody saying that all Muslims are this, or all white people are this, or all Latinos are that, and to think about the square and how it plays out in people's logic and in their failure to think logically. Okay, that's enough for now. Until next time.